Now I want to look at all these, you know, viscous hydro models and the tropical dynamics from some kind of general perspective, from some, using some well-defined methodology, and this methodology is based on the gradient function. And now I want to say that I understand by the gradient expansion that the formal expansion of T mu nu in this form. So we start with the equilibrium form, and then we have a series of curves, and the trends are expressed and as powers of gradients of T and U mu. And this is just the formal definition of the gradient hydrodynamic expansion. Of course, there's some issue with the terminology, and now I prefer to use somehow two concepts. One concept is this of the hydrodynamic gradient expansion, which is just this expansion as it is written here. And then we can talk about some hydrodynamic expansions, which are just kind of tools to start from some microscopic theory and get hydrodynamic theory. And such hydrodynamic expansions usually refer to some extra concepts, use some heuristic steps. For instance, if we use this burst approach, we start with the gradient expansion, but then we use some concepts about using Navier-Stokes to close the equation. Yeah? So there is some heuristic point. If you use this DNMR approach, we have this double expansion in the Knudsen number, so in the gradients, and also in the inverse Reynolds number. So there are some heuristic arguments, there's some extra information, not only gradients, just to complete and to formulate hydrodynamic equation. But gradient expansion is like this. And so this is the formal tool really to make comparison between different theories and to check the behavior with the systems approach equilibrium. But this is not a good approach to find approximate solutions of the theory, as we know, because this expansion doesn't include hydrodynamic ones. So, for instance, you know, I have some schematic pictures. For instance, you have the underlying microscopic model or theory, let's say ADS-CFT. So then you can do this gradient expansion. I discussed this during my first lecture, and then you can calculate the coefficients in this expansion, and then, for instance, you can determine the viscosity. On the other hand, you can take some phenomenological hydrodynamic model. So you can take, for instance, burst approach with free kinetic coefficients, and then you can compare kinetic coefficients and just transfer the knowledge from the microscopic theory to the phenomenological model. So this, I would say, the most favorite, it seems very reasonable approach to do. You have some microscopic theories, you make gradient expansion, you get information about the kinetic coefficient from microscopic theory into gradient expansion, and then you transfer this to phenomenological models which are easier to use, like Python. And this has been done for ADS-CFT in one dimension, and this has been done also for the kinetic theory in the relaxation time approximation. Another comparison can be done also if you have microscopic theory and then you have hydro, which is based on this theory. This is kind of a delicate issue there, because suppose that you start with the kinetic theory as your microscopic model, and then you make expansion in the Knudsen number and inverse Reynolds number. And then you come to, let's say, equations written by DNMR. So then what you can do, just to check maybe whether everything is okay, you can make expansion of the kinetic theory, the gradient expansion, like this, and then you can make expansion of the hydrodynamic model and check whether everything is consistent. So this is like checking the self-consistency of everything. So then, how it works? So usually, in practice, this is done for one-dimensional expansion, because then everything is really under control and doable, because the system is quite simple. And if we have, for instance, anisotropic expansion or viscous expansion, then usually we have two independent parameters. We have effective temperature and the shear stress or anisotropic parameters. So we expand them in gradients. Now, for Bjork and Flom, all gradients are just inverse powers of the proper time. D mu, U mu is 1 over tau, if you calculate the shear flow tensor, it's also given by some inverse power of the proper time. So for instance, if you start with the temperature and you want to express this in terms of gradients, you have the leading term, which is the Bjorken solution. So you have some scale, then you have term which goes like 1 over tau to 1/3. You remember entropy goes like 1 over the proper time, temperature goes like the third root from entropy, so it goes like 1/3. Yeah. And then you add some extra powers. You have to look at these equations. I showed them before only to demonstrate that they are highly non-linear, complicated. But if you make these ansatz and you insert into this equation, then you really immediately see which powers should appear in this expansion to make reasonable development of those functions. So actually T looks like this. There are some inverse powers of tau. And then, you know, I put some coefficients here. Maybe what's important in this expansion is that there is a coefficient C here, to the power n, and C is related to the filtration time, because now everything will be done for the conformal system, so the system with massless particles, and you want to have the equilibration time inversely proportional to the temperature. Because the system is conformal, there is no scale if you put it into the medium, so the only scale is the temperature. So all dimensional parameters should depend on the temperature, so the relaxation time should be inversely proportional to the temperature, so it's C over T. So C is kind of factorized in this expansion, and then if you do expansion of the anisotropy, then you can also check that there are some idling powers of the proper time. But this is kind of very easy to control. The important thing is that you have these expansions in inverse powers of the proper time. And then you put all these series into ordinary coupled differential equations, and you compare the coefficients. In this way, you can get the coefficients Tn, we define T.
What was Xi voided?
Xi was the anisotropy parameter, which was the parameter which was describing how longitudinal direction differs from the transverse. So the spheroidal the formation when system is close to equilibrium, Xi is proportional to the shear tensor component, the only one which is relevant in this case. Okay, so these expansions look quite ugly, I would say, because of these non-natural powers. But Yanni realized in one of those papers that the nice variable to discuss is W. This is not this W introduced by Gavaz and Chenshu, the compensatory kinetic theory. This variable I mentioned in my first lecture. This is the product of the proper time and the temperature. So W defined this way is dimensionless, and one can expect that if you make the expansion of the W, it goes with inverse integer powers of the W, because you know at large times T goes like 1 over tau to 1/3. So this goes like tau to 4/3. And so this is the dimension of the energy density of pressure. And so if you expand this function, then you expect really that it goes with these integers. So from the Bjorken model, with the inclusion of the viscosity, you construct the function f, which is the logarithmic derivative of this guy with respect to the proper time. And then you see that f is related to the difference of the two pressures. So this I already mentioned, and so I repeat this. And f starts with 2/3, and this is just the local equilibrium. And then there will be further terms in this expansion, so f1 will be related to the viscosity. And so one has to use such expansions and then change everything into the series in W. Okay, and now, you know, there was the paper by Helle Kukela and Kamisi, it's published in September last year, but the calculations were done already, I guess, 1 year ago, and they were coming to us just trying to get some contact and to do some comparisons, because what is done in this paper is just the gradient expansion for this relaxation time kinetic theory. So this is very simplistic kinetic theory, but the advantage is that you can solve it exactly. And you know, if you can solve something exactly, it's always useful, you know. Some people say that in physics you can solve exactly only the gas, the non-interacting gas and harmonic oscillator. It's not true, but you know, each system which can be solved exactly is very much useful for comparison. So what they did, they started with the kinetic theory, with the relaxation time approximation, and made this formal expansion of this non-equilibrium approach. Before, they did the gradient expansion for the ADS-CFT. Using ADS-CFT correspondence, they made the expansion of this conformal fit theory and this for Young means. So this was done before. Later, they got interested in the kinetic theory, so they made this gradient expansion for RTA. And they got some numbers. You know, this 2/3 for the equilibrium, then 4/45. This corresponds to viscosity in some way and some other terms. Then they really become very complicated fractions. They did, I think, up to the term something like 200. So these are approximations for these numbers because they are really complicated fractions. So these are the numbers, and then you can different approaches. For instance, you can take different hydrodynamic models, and then you can check the gradient expansion for the hydrodynamic model. So this is the repetition of these equations which I had at the end of the second lecture, but actually I showed it earlier today. You have this, so this is the most popular interactive version of hydrodynamics. Tau phi is one of the shear stress components which are close to equilibrium proportional to this anisotropic parameter. There's first theory which has different terms, and then the DNMR which looks like this. Yeah. So when you look at this, you see you have different equations, and so what to do with them. So the gradient expansion, this formal gradient expansion, is the kind of machine which helps you to make comparison and make sense out of this. You know? So, but I think in each case the attitude is a little bit different, you know, because if you have first, then you have the theory which is defined by general principles, you can take kinetic coefficients which are not defined. So you simply do the gradient expansion for first to define the values of the kinetic coefficients. So this is the most, I would say, traditional approach to do. And when you look at this line, you have relaxation time, viscosity, and the coefficient lambda 1. Relaxation time goes like C over T, so it's not a free parameter, it factorizes. So we have two free parameters. So actually you can fix the term N1 and 2, and this is really what is shown here. 2/3 is automatic because this is local equilibrium, so all such series start with 2/3, and later there are some other terms, but in this case, you just take the theory with free kinetic coefficients and you feed them to the exact theory. Or you feed them to the measured values in the experiment and so on. But you can go up to n equals 2, and later, usually you don't agree, because there's no reason to have an agreement, because this is just the expansion up to second order ingredients. So this works as it's somehow designed to work, and later it doesn't work. Now, if you take DNMR, and this I think is beautiful, because when you look at these equations, they are completely different. And also, in the case of DNMR, there is a different strategy, because DNMR is just rooted in the kinetic theory. So there is no freedom for the kinetic coefficients. They are all known, you calculate them using kinetic theory methods. And so all these coefficients which are here, like viscosity, so they are, like actually in this case you see there is only viscosity and there is some, you know, coefficient which is calculated in the relaxation time approximation, and then you see that you get also the agreement up to the second order. So I think this beautiful result which shows you that with this help of the gradient expansion, you see that the two approaches are consistent up to the second order, So they are designed to work up to the second order ingredients, and they work. But later they don't work because there's no reason that they should work. Yeah. But yeah. So actually, yeah. So I want to emphasize that there are different, I think, attitudes in these two approaches, because one is kind of general, refers to some general concepts, and kinetic coefficients are free, they should be adjusted to the to other microscopic theory or to experiment. And in this way you get the agreement, because you feed them. In this case there is no freedom, because you just calculate them from the kinetic theory, because DNMR is rooted in the kinetic theory, yeah? So this is the theory that starts. When you take this, then you see that the third term is wrong. And this is also bad, yeah? So it's just, yeah, so it shows that, again, that one has to use complete set of terms to have some agreement with the kinetic theory, yeah? So, again, it shows that these are two are biggest naive version is not the good thing. Of course, you might say that maybe quantitatively is not so important in some cases, but I think if we can do, we should do the best. And in this case, you said really that we should use, you know, the advanced hydrodynamic models which are now available. And Israel Stewart has some efficiency. So this is really nice that this...
Can I interrupt you?
Sure.
I thought that this DRSS was calculated for conformality.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this form already assumed that you have a conformal theory. There were additional terms you have mentioned, which were put equal to zero because you have a conformality. And in the other approaches, you do not assume anything about conformality.
Yeah, but you can put masses to zero in the conformal case. So these are, in this case, they are more general, but they are referring to the kinetic theory. So they can be done for the conformal system described by the kinetic theory.
So you compare all this comparison is done, yeah, for the conformal case.
Of course, there was a lot of discussion because there is, you know, when you start, for instance, when you start the kinetic theory, then usually you don't get in the relaxation time the term is goes like phi squared. So in birth, they got phi squared, and then there was some discussion during the conference that this term is just coming from this conformal symmetry argument, and it's a new one because in other approaches you don't have it. But the point is that this term is not unique. Unfortunately, I think there is, you know, the point is that this heuristic point used by your collaborators is not unique, yeah, because the situation was like this, the pi mu nu was written as many terms including sigma mu nu with the time derivative, and then here, and actually there were some other terms here which contained sigma mu alpha, sigma alpha nu, also one has to take orthogonal parts, symmetric and so on, so brackets denote this. And now here, what we do, we say that sigma mu nu is just pi mu nu divided by 2 eta, and then we get dynamic equations for pi mu nu, because then this disappears, pi is promoted to independent variable. But you have these terms, and of course there's ambiguity here, because you can make this substitution and then you get pi squared. But you can substitute only one term, so you can have pi times sigma, you can take one half of the sum, and so on. So this term, which is in the second line, phi squared, corresponds to this substitution, but is not unique. So you see somehow that if you have terms of this type, then they are all really related if you go to the second order. They just should be equivalent to one term. And this calculation really shows this, because This goes like phi squared, and in this case we have phi over tau, and 1 over tau is just the sigma for the Bjorken expansion, for the Bjorken geometry. So this goes like, phi is this single independent component in pi, so this phi squared is like pi squared on the vector. Yeah, it's just the shear component squared. In this case, it's one component of the shear tensor multiplied by the one component of the shear flow tensor, 1 over tau. So this goes like pi squared, this goes like pi sigma. And this goes with different coefficients, but actually when you do this gradient expansion, then you see that they are the same. In practice, when you make this gradient expansion, so they make the same physics. The same viscosity, they define the same viscosity effects. These two, I would say, approaches up to maybe not viscosity because this is related to this coefficient, so it's not viscosity. So viscosity is the first one. But up to the second order in gradients, they are equivalent. So I think this expansion shows that this is really so. But I think there was a lot of kind of arguments that this is the new term because it doesn't appear here, but they are equivalent, and this calculation shows that this is equivalent. But of course, if you go further than of equilibrium, then you see that there are problems. Yeah? So you see that somehow this is not the good. Approximation for that solution. Now, okay, I have some statements written because I really wanted to say everything here. So, two approaches are equivalent after the second order. Relaxation time is fixed by the conformality, so it is the inverse of the temperature. C factorizes, so it's not independent here. Bruce agrees because it has three parameters which can be fixed to the theory. On the other hand, PLMR agrees with the RTA because it's also rooted in the kinetic theory, so it nicely shows that it agrees. Standard Israel Stewart is good only for n equals 1, yeah? For already the second order is wrong, yeah? So it shows that it's not complete to the second order, the standard approaches. Yeah. Okay. Now we can do similar things with anisotropic hydrodynamics. So we have exact results from the kinetic theory, verse, and two versions of A-hydro. And then you see that this is poor and this is good. I think this AH2 is this anisotropic hydro based on this anisotropic matching principle, and this really works the best. So again, we see that this approach is somehow some way superior compared to others using this gradient expansion. Before we saw that it's quite good when we were comparing exact solutions of the kinetic theory, but these were numerical illustrations, or this was kind of numerical evidence that this approach is the appropriate one. But in this case, we look for this region where the systems approach equilibrium, and then we also can control how this works. So the gradient expansion defined formally in this way is the kind of machinery to compare different theories, microscopic theories with effective models, to compare different hydrodynamic approaches, and then to transfer the knowledge from microscopic models to other models. Now, the situation is that quite interesting. What happens if you calculate exactly further terms in the gradient expansion? So this has been done for young supersymmetric young medias, and then by I think Janik, Tasik, Spaliński, and they show that the series has zero convergence readings. Yeah, so it's asymptotic series. It's cannot be good approximation to the solution. Yeah. So, and in the case of the kinetic theory, what they did with Alexei Kurkela is again showing the same situation. So, if you calculate the coefficients Gn, they go like n factorial. So it's so the series is not converging, and so we have asymptotic series, And so this situation is like in electrodynamics, like in the 50 years, so that you have first few terms which are very good approximation for the physics, but if you include more terms, then you lose agreement, yeah? And the quantum field theory, you know that there are some effects like instantons which cannot be expressed as the series expansion. And in this case, you also know that there are some features like, for instance, in non-hydrodynamic modes, which cannot be written simply like the expansion in gradients. Look at my example where the system is isotropic at the beginning, so it will not start. If your dynamic equation expresses the time derivative to gradients in space. Well, so there is increase, they grow like the factorials. So what I can do, I can do the Borel transform. So I can take the coefficients, divide them by n factorial, and then one can start another function. So one can make Borel transform. And what those people started doing an analytic structure of this function, of the Borel transform, and then use the Padé approximants to do for this structure. The Padé transform is just the ratio to polynomials. So the idea is like this. Let's calculate 200 coefficients. So these Fn coefficients up to 200, yeah? Then you construct, you take the function which is the ratio of two polynomials. In the numerator you have the polynomial of the order of, let's say, 100, the denominator also 100. So you have 200 coefficients, and then you fix the 200 coefficients in this approximation by the ratio of polynomials to this function, because you have 200 coefficients here. And then when you have this Padé approximant, then you look for the poles, and then you see that there is a cut, and there is the beginning of this cut, which is related directly to the non-hydrodynamic mode, because in the kinetic theory, you have this exponential damping because it's 1 over tau equilibrium term. And at the beginning of the evolution, you have the exponential damping. And this is exactly, you know, this beginning of this cut. So you may say this is the first pole. It defines this non-hydrodynamic pole. So there is, you know, so although this gradient expansion loses the information about this non-hydrodynamic modes. So when you make this Borel resumation, then you somehow get information about this. I think there are still some conjectures about this, because I think this was also based on some numerical evidence, because first, this was found in the context of the super symmetric young rings, and then it was also confirmed for this RTL. So the situation is like this, that one can make this gradient expansion. Only the first terms make sense to make some approximate models, hydrodynamic models. If you make this Borel resumation, it's very likely that you really get the information about these non-hydrodynamic models. So now the situation is like this. The gradient expansion gives you the information about the behavior close to equilibrium and at the beginning, when the system is out of equilibrium. Because first terms in the gradient expansion are expressed by the kinetic coefficients which control approach to equilibrium. On the other hand, this value of non-hydrodynamic modes tell you what happens at the beginning, at least in these examples. Yeah. What happens inside is out of control using these methods at the moment. But then we have all these exact solutions which can be used to see what happens in this intermediate range. So I think it's quite fascinating, and this now there's a lot of development in this idea of those ideas, because this gradient expansion can be developed to so-called trans series. So one combines this gradient expansion with these non-hydrodynamic models, and there is the whole theory which is called resurgence, which is now really developed. So we are touching now really very new things, and I think this is really quite interesting, because, you know, we are doing hydro. I never expected that I would encounter the problems in hydrodynamics, which has something to do with asymptotic expansion of of QED, for instance. But then when you look into the literature, then you know that you realize that that some clever people found something before. But because when I learned about this and I started looking into the literature, I realized that there's the paper by Grad from 1950s, where he already realized that gradient expansion for the kinetic theory is something serious. And then he cites the very David Hilbert. So all those guys already knew about this, you know, about this asymptotic series, and they were discussing the relation between hydro and the kinetic theory. So this, I think, is really a very exciting topic because, you know, there was the field medal given to some mathematicians who discussed entropy production in the kinetic theory. So I think this is really somehow exciting thing from the intellectual point of view, but, you know, now I'm only touching this. Yeah, so I will be progressive still to show you some results. Okay, so now I stop this topic with the gradient expansion. I want to go to some exact solution using different hydro. And now let's forget about Bose invariance. Let's just calculate the situation where at the beginning you have kind of Gaussian distribution of matter in rapidity, and then you have some expansion. And then you can also see what happens in different viscous hydrodynamic modes. And so in this case, the viscosity is again corresponding to the lower bound. We start at 0.25 Fermi C or 0.2. So there is first a shot which shows some profiles like 1 Fermi. And you know, thin line is the ideal hydro, and what is shown here is theta parallel. So this is the correction to the rapidity, because we define the rapidity of the fluid as the space-time rapidity plus some correction. And this correction is written here. So for the Bose invariant model, this is zero because the rapidity of the fluid element is equal to the space-time rapidity. So if you know the space-time position, you know the velocity of the fluid element. Usually if you have gradient, then you have the push and the system accelerates, so it gets velocity which are larger than the initial velocity. And it's better to really just see if you have gas distribution of matter, this is rapidity, space-time rapidity. If you go to the right value, then system accelerates, theta parallel is positive, this is negative. When you look at different, you know, versions of hydro, then you see also similar behavior. But then when you look at the correction of from the viscosity, which is now denoted as pi s. Sorry for this because I have figures from different papers. Now this pi s is more or less what phi was in the previous figure. So this is the viscous correction to the pressure. So we divide the viscous correction, which is present in this shear stress tensor, by the equilibrium pressure, and this is R. And then this is noted here. You immediately see that when you have this standard viscous code like miss, then or burst, even then it immediately is larger than one. So it contradicts all these approximations that this is small. So actually you cannot use really hydro here. But when this ratio is larger than one, it means also the longitudinal pressure is negative. So when you have this system, so actually at the edges you have really completely right. Negative pressure, somehow corrections which are really very, very large. And then in the next slides I can show you how it evolves in time. So the situation is really even worse, because you know these pressures become even more negative. But fortunately A-hydro is very stable in this case, because A-hydro you know, it goes to 1. So I think it's a very beautiful example of this anisotropic hydro works, because at the edges of the system pressure is 0, so it's simply there is no matter, and the rapidity this correction is going to zero, so it means that you have kind of free stream of the particles. Yeah? So it's really nicely described. And I think this is a very old problem in hydro, yeah? Because we want to describe the center the central part of the system, which is close to equilibrium, and you get rid of the edges. But you cannot get rid of the edges from the beginning because you change the initial conditions, and then you get some garbage at the places where you cut the first garbage. So the garbage goes to the center. Yes? So usually you run hydro just with the system which extends to large regions, and only at the end you just get rid of the edges. Yeah? But the anisotropic hydro, you see that this is really nicely done. And the last plot shows somehow the phase-out curve is based on rapidity, and so we plot again this ratio for this correction of the pressure here, and then you see that it's really very close to unity, which shows that we are very close to the region where this hydro doesn't work. This is the space-time region, so the space-time rapidity, proper time, and red regions are really bad pressure, and there is some, you know, typical hydro service which is which has this shape. So at the beginning the system freezes at the edges, at the end it freezes in the central part. But you see that usually when we make this freeze-out curve, then we are very close to this kind of dangerous region. So if you want to make this hydro step by step, then we are really in danger that we are coming to this really, I would say, non-physical regions. But fortunately, in the very center, everything is consistent, so then it works well. Yeah. The last topic is that, you know, Mike Strickland is working with his colleagues on feeding the LAC data with the anisotropic hydro dynamics, and he got very beautiful agreement for the rapidity distribution, Vt, V2, so you know, so A hydro can be used also for phenomenology, and it works pretty well. Okay, so now conclusion. So relativistic viscous hydrodynamics really plays the fundamental role to understand the processes of PVR and collision. This is kind of tool which is necessary to go from some initial conditions which are determined by geometry to some final states. But we need hydro because hydro describes the formation of this collective flow. So this is kind of crucial ingredient of all successful models. If we do such modeling, then we can fit the parameters of the plasma. We have access to determine the equation of state and also the values of the kinetic coefficients. The success of hydro, of course, triggered all this activity about formal aspects, and this is really now a flourishing field, and people also who did string theory are very much interested in the kinetic theory. So this, I showed you, I think interesting a new development, and showed you that people are really interested in aspects, and I think we understand more really what hydro is. This gradient expansion tells you that really the application of hydro is limited only to this first term. So there is no sense to make gradient expansion to calculate further kinetic coefficients in my opinion, because the series is asymptotic, so they cannot be used. Yeah. So I think probably we have to stop. So if you use this traditional approach, I think we have to stop at the second order, and that's it. But on the other hand, I think this example with A hydro shows you that you can construct the hydrodynamic theory in the direct relation to some microscopic theory. And then you can somehow describe better the behavior of this microscopic system. So there is some, I think, trend to adjust hydro to some microscopic models. I give you one example. There is also some activity by Roman Janik and collaborators where they considered this Janik supersymmetric Janik again. They found non-hydrodynamic modes in this model, and they construct hydrodynamic equations to include those non-hydrodynamic modes. And in this way, you can construct hydrodynamic theories which are in the direct relation to some fundamental theories. So we can know, for instance, non-hydrodynamic mode for QCD, then you can just adjust hydro to QCD there. Okay, I think that's it for the lectures. Thank you a lot. did?
Yeah.
Okay, so, you know, the exercises are very simple and just general physics. But I cannot just. You know, there are 10 exercises which are really like from the high school. What I always start when I have, you know, some tutorials in elementary programs. First, natural system of units, because we always use them blindly. Like 1 GB is 5 over 30, and so on. So, I think you should do it at home, more or less. The second exercise is about the energy density of normal nuclear matter. And if you just calculate it, you see that it corresponds to this value. So it's 0.16 GB per Fermi. So it's quite low. And I want to emphasize that when you make all these calculations based on the Bjorken model, then you immediately see that you get orders of magnitude more. Yeah? So it's out of question that this matter which is producing in such collisions is really denser than nuclear matter, and there is somehow no reason to talk about particles, about hadrons which exist at the very early stages. Yeah? It's kind of percolation argument. Yeah? So I think when people say, oh, why do you think that wormhole plasma was formed? So first answer is that for sure there are no hadrons, I would say, there, because the hadrons have size, and so they overlap, we see one on another, so I think when you get two orders of magnitude here from the Bjorken model, then it means that it doesn't make any sense to talk about nucleons in the beginning, that they form some kind of matter. So I would say first argument about new state of matter, which is very simple, is kind of percolation argument. Then of course there are problems because we want to say, okay, the system consists of quarks and gluons, but they interact very strongly, the mid-field path is very short, the wavelength is very long. So, oh my god, so even I cannot use the concept of the particles. Oh, well, not all. Okay, so then I guess, okay, so let's use hydro in Bruce formulation, it has no connection with particles, so let's use it and this is safe, yeah? Also, when you use this ADS-CFT correspondence, then you don't refer to the particle concept. So this, I think, very advantageous at the moment. Yeah. So it somehow, at these early stages, we probably have the system which, you know, which of course consists of quarks and gluons, but it's hardly to treat them as the elementary excitation in the system. But should be some look for some quasi particles. So there are some efforts. Okay, third exercise is kinetic energy of a track. Well, then there's some, you know, exercises about participant and spectator, some geometric thing. So if we want to get some feeling, we can do some simple geometric calculations and determine them. Then the transverse momentum spectra, which are exponential, and so this is again kind of technical simple exercise. We should get you some practice with the Bessel function, which are very, very common there. And another exercise is about the properties of the rapidity, which is additive, and the properties of pseudo rapidity, which is not additive, under Lorentz Boost. Then maybe there's one exercise which I like because I think it's elementary physics related to whose invariance it is not known. So we have you know. So the idea is that, you know, all people say that, you know, if you have whose invariance in the product of this form, we know, but it's not about truth. Yeah? So maybe I just show you this. So usually, when you have this Boosian invariant flow, we say that it has this form 1 over the proper time, and then you have P, 0, 0, and then C. Yeah? So it looks like this. But actually, it's not the general form is very, very peculiar form, and this form which is shown in the slide is also, it is also to the music variant. Okay, from here you can get the longitudinal street velocity just taking t in front of everything, then you get 1, 0, 0, and then you have 0 over t. Yeah? So then you see that longitudinal street velocity is 0 over t. So this I would say is multivariant, but it's not multivariant form. Now, how we really have to ask the question about the multivariants? So each physics quantity has some properties which are related to the Lorentz transformation. Yeah, we have scalar fields, Fourier curves, and so on. And depending on the Lorentz property, we have I think the conditions look a little bit different in practice. The idea is that somehow after the transformation, the symmetry, nothing really changes. So for instance, if you have a scalar field, so then the scalar field phi, let's say, so by definition, scalar field transformed in this way that the new field in the new spacetime point is equal to the old field in the old field. So this is the definition of the scalar function. So for instance, if you have temperature or pressure, energy density, pressure, they should transform like this. But then, if you say that you want to have a symmetric system which is losing variant, then this new field at the new place should agree with the old field in the new space. Yeah? It means somehow that you make some transformation, you find new field in the new place, but then you get old field in the new place. Yeah? So this is the new condition which really tells you how we define this property. Yeah? So what is here is the definition of the scalar field, and this what is here is the Poussin variance. Yeah? So for instance, from here you see that the value of this function phi should be equal to 2 points which are connected by the Lorentz transformation. Yeah? So this is when you have x prime, which is Lorentz transformation times x, then you see that the system, this scalar function is losing variant. Well, so okay, so it's a similar situation like with the rotation, because rotation actually is also Lorentz transformation. So then you see that somehow making rotation, then the function should be the same. So for instance, for rotation, it's obvious that the function, the scalar function, depends on the distance, yeah? Because the distance doesn't change, so then it's okay. For the scalar functions which depend on t and z, so if for instance we have t which depends on t and z, so then this condition which is here tells you somehow that t is a function of the proton. So this is easy, and very often people say only about this. But if you have the, for instance, four velocity, then the situation is a little bit more complicated, because then you have the situation of like this, that new field at the new place is given by the Lorentz transformation, L mu nu, and then you have u nu at the old place. Yeah? So this is the definition of the vector field transformation. And the Poussin invariance in this case tells you that the new field at the new place should be equal to the old field at the new place. So, because then nothing changes really. So then we deal with the symmetries. Now, how to treat this equation in a simple way? Right, recently Professor Ronios Lubczynski told me that I gave exercises in my book, but I didn't need a solution and couldn't solve this. So he was complaining. So I think the idea to solve this, the simplest, is to look for infinitesimal transformations. When you look at the infinitesimal transformation, when the root L is delta mu nu plus some epsilon mu nu, then you can make plus expansion here in epsilon, and then you get very simple differential equations with constant coefficients. When you solve them, then you get, for instance, for the scalar function, this So in this case, it's unfortunately more complicated because you have vector equation, and if you make use of infinitesimal Lorentz transformation, then the equation become more complicated, but not so much. But yes, yeah, so anyway, this Boose invariance is a kind of condition which is imposed on the fields, and depending on the type of the field, you have different conditions, and then you get this structure from this condition. And I think this example is somehow the illustration that you can have somehow flow, which is Boose invariant, but not given by this Bjorken form. And maybe I should tell you this something about this form. So, now for the Bjorken model, it's very nice and useful to introduce the proper time and also the space-time rapidity. Space-time rapidity is 1/2 log t plus z t minus z, and the proper time is the square root t squared minus z squared, and then the inverse transformation is such that t is the proper time approach eta, and z is tau c. So actually this equation can be written, you know, from this, using this parameterization, we see that this is the fourth vector which has this component. And now, if you make Lorentz transformation, then this eta is additive. Yes. So if you make Lorentz transformation, if you go to other Lorentz frame, then you get u prime, which is Lorentz transformation, which depends on, you can also, it depends on some rapidity theta and u. And the result is like this, that this theta is added to eta parameter. Yeah? Because this I want to represent as cosh theta sinh theta sinh theta cosh theta line line. So if we multiply this vector by this matrix, what we really get, we get ch eta plus theta, and then 0, 0, 0, so eta plus theta. But this one, this is nothing else but theta prime, the space-time rapidity in the new system. Yeah? So it really fits to these general concepts I told you before, because if we have Lorentz transformation, then this Lorentz transformation is somehow reduced to putting only the prime on the parameter. Yeah? Somehow we don't have to, if you have a symmetry, we don't have to really make the transformation, it's enough to make prime, and that's it for the scalar function. Yeah? And in this case also, somehow the u prime is like this, if we use the Lorentz transformation, but you see that this is really this eta prime, which is u1. So if you make this Lorentz transformation, then it gives some eta prime, which is 1/2 log t prime plus z prime, t prime minus z prime. Now, okay, so this this function. Makes sense with A and B different from zero. So let's say that A is different from zero and B is different from zero. So let's divide by A. So then what we get is B over A, let's say A. So for Z minus A T divided by T minus A Z. Okay, so this form is equivalent. Unless there is some, you know, singular version of this exercise. But now, another step one should figure out is that when we want to calculate Vz, let's say, at z equals 0, then we get Vz, which is minus a over t divided by t. So this is minus a. Okay, so this example makes sense when a is smaller than 1. Because we want to have figures smaller than the speed of light. Okay, so then what we do? So what we do? We use space-time relativity. So z is tau sinh theta minus a tau cos theta divided by tau cos theta minus a tau. We just cancel tau, the proper tau. Let's calculate, divide the numerator and the denominator by cos of eta. So then we get tangent eta minus a divided by 1 minus a tangent eta. Okay, so now I guess probably you know what I want to do, because a is smaller than 1, and I can say that a is something tangent, hyperbolic, or some parameter. Okay, so I like that one. And then what I get is tangent eta minus tangent a, tangent theta divided by 1 minus tangent theta. So now you. So. And then this is the tangent of eta plus theta. So then. So what turns out is that this form, which looks so strange, is a kind of. You know, in the standard case we have dz, which was tangent eta. So now you see that this really corresponds to the law which is boosted. So. What is behind this formula, which looks strange, is nothing like the flow, which is not zero at zero. It's like, you know, like we started, it looks like we started the analysis in the framework, the system has kind of momentum, which is not zero, that's the total one. So now, because this is kind of fixed value, I can maybe put some theta zero here. Then you can immediately see that that t velocity which is there corresponds to the four vector which has this form sinh eta plus theta 0, 0, 0, cos eta plus theta 0. So when you make Lorentz transformation, you get still under this argument the rapidity of the Lorentz transformation, so this is again two-invariant flow. So this is just the exercise just to motivate you to think about these two-invariants. You really didn't take it as granted, they take this formula from the Gödel model. There's some, you know, in general physics behind this, which can be worked out as a nice kind of exercise in special relativity. So There's something about fitness function, and the last exercise is about the calculation of the equation of state of the hormone plasma and just perturbative hormone plasma. No, there are solutions and keys to this exercise in my book, so if somebody's interested, of course, look into this. Okay, thank you a lot. Thank you a lot.
So, is there any other question?
You want to ask something?
Yes.
You look,
yeah, you look
a little bit nervous. You are humming. Yeah.
I guess then I will close this section.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. So now we have 8 minutes for